Well, the role is multifaceted, but primarily, you know, carrying out the mission of the region in a real way for the states of the Mid-Atlantic. And it's a variety of things. The reputation of EPA, as we know, is a regulatory agency, but that's not all we are. You know, we're also a grant maker. We're also an educator. We're also provide technical assistance, and we're also a convener for all the stakeholders, and not just those who we regulate, but nonprofit organizations and philanthropy as well. You know, the environment is all hands on deck enterprise. It's complex. It's big. It's the biggest thing, you know, in the region. And it really requires really close coordination and partnership with anybody who wants to help. So that's how I see the role. And the Bay Program is, you know, precisely in that vein, you know, with a specific focus with specific outcomes. So I feel that I'm sort of the captain of the team or the manager of the team. You know, if you're taking a baseball metaphor, forgive the sports metaphors, everybody. But the staff is super talented. We have lots of marching orders. The program is very robust. You know, my job is to help sort of clear the way for the program to be as successful as possible. Well, there's a lot to choose from. So I have a couple of favorite little hiking spots. One of them is Scott's Run, which is just south of Great Falls on the Virginia side. Great little park there without the parking debacle that is at the, you know, National Park area. But I'm a big fan of the Canaan Valley, West Virginia. So it's a beautiful area. There's a few municipalities there that I love. Davis, West Virginia, actually is one of my favorite places. Great little breweries and restaurants and good quality of life. So big fan of that. But I'm a big hiker. I love kayaking. So I get out on the Anacostia River a lot, which isn't too far from my home. But I'm happy to take any and all recommendations. Yeah, it's tough to pick because everything has to be successful if we're going to restore the bay. So it's not like we're going to put this aside while we do something else. We have to keep it moving, and we have the staff and enough people involved to keep it moving. But, you know, there's, to use the stop the bleeding metaphor, Pennsylvania agriculture is a major focus right now for me. And since my first day in the office, I've been focused on trying to work with others in remedying some of the deficiencies. And those are, some of them are state in the state legislature. We need more partner state. Some of it is coordination with nonprofits, funders, and the private sector to help, you know, promote more sustainable practices and some of the most distressed areas, and just having a very on the ground, thoughtful engagement with the folks in Pennsylvania who are going to be partners in solving the issue. Yeah, great question. DEIJ work is not something that we do on the side of our programs, or it's not something that, those people over there, they work on that. This is something that we do every day. And it's a way that we look at our work, not just in the Bay, but in our air programs and our brownfield and Superfund programs and our public engagement. Who are we talking to? Are we engaging everybody? And are we being thoughtful and equitable in the deployment of our time and our resources to address, you know, a lot of phenomena that predate us, you know, in some ways? Historical phenomena, history of segregation, redlining, race and class divisions. And are we doing everything we can to be mindful and remedy, some of those undesirable historical practices? So we can do stuff. What does that mean practically? So already underway, we've been working with Akia and others on mapping the region using EJ screen and some other demographic data to just be very focused on what are our communities that are in distress. And we're looking at environmental stressors as well as economic stressors and other indicators of marginalized communities. And having identified them, and there's many in the Chesapeake Bay watershed, to have a strategic plan for practically, you know, making a difference on some of those stressors. And that could be inspections, that could be grant, that could be partnering with the town or the city or the county. So all that is in the works. Well, there's a lot of things that need to happen, but the most important thing is that, as I put it, we're on the field. So we have to be fully engaged for the outcomes. You know, we have technical assistance, we have funding, we have smart people, we have examples of others, but we also need to show that, you know, we are a regulatory agency also at the end of the day, and that we will be willing to take a tougher tack on permitting, on inspections, on enforcement, on, you know, whatever we need to do to get outcomes for pollution reduction. So before the holidays, I made clear to one of our states that we will do what we have to do to get results and use our powers. But that's true, period, you know, across the watershed. We're gonna, you know, do everything we can, including being the nice guy or the nice gal. But sometimes, you know, maybe there's other strategies that are less nice that are also required. So, and then the last thing I'll say is all of this is working together. So, you know, we do all those pieces and we're highly engaged. So we're always working with the stakeholders. We're talking with legislators. We're talking with permittees because, you know, we're here to get outcomes. You know, we're here to do the work that we're here to do under EPA's mission. And we're here to leave it in a better place for the next group of folks who take these jobs that you and I have. Yeah, it's a biggie. There's no question about it. And just to backtrack, it's a little bit close to home. In my background in my career was criminal justice reform and human rights. And I was the mayor of a little town in the Bay watershed, specifically on the Anacostia. And we suffered from terrible flooding year after year. And we know now, you know, we have terms for it. It's called, you know, micro severe storm events. And then we, you know, were able to manage it through infrastructure with levees and almost a $10 million flood pumping station. And that's what we know today as adaptation and resilience. But in the early 2000s, you know, we were sort of hit with this. So, you know, there's a few things that we have to do. There's that resilience and adaptation. The climate is changing and coastal communities, but not just coastal communities, are more vulnerable. So, you know, there is that sort of hardscape, that infrastructure that we have to address, but we're still not giving up on mitigation. And that's the root causes of carbon. That's the root causes of all the inputs that go into making things more unstable. So, you know, that's where the air programs come in. You know, water and air, they are connected. They're in different divisions here, but there's, you know, no silos in the environment. So we're going to address those as well. Also use data and science. So there's been a lot of great work on modeling and expectations of all sorts of outcomes. Clearly, the changing climate introduces a lot of new variables into our models. Some of them, you know, we're anticipating, some we're not quite sure what we're going to see. So we need to really have our ear on the ground and be thoughtful and adaptive, you know, based on, you know, what phenomena we're seeing through the data and through reality. Yeah, there's no question that stormwater is in growing stormwater pollution is a major threat to the health of the Bay. You know, we have some regulatory tools. We have our MS4 permits and, you know, we've done several generations of permits. So, you know, we have more intelligence and sophistication in how we deploy it. But this is, you know, in the theme of all hands on deck. We can't be the only ones coming up with solutions. A lot of these are local planning decisions. These are zoning decisions. These are decisions at the municipal level, whether it's a county or a city. So one of the powers that we have, and we don't always think of it as a power, is the power to convene in the government. You know, we're the government, you know, everybody is our constituent, you know, many stakeholders, and we can bring together, you know, all sorts of intelligence from all sorts of sectors to the issue. You know, this isn't just happening in one place or another place. Everybody's dealing with the same phenomena of you know, growing urbanized areas, increased stormwater runoff, and the impacts of it. And there are solutions. There's all sorts of best practices. So in the theme of convening, what we're going to be doing in the spring is hosting a region-wide conference for best practices. So, you know, we could tell, you know, some municipality, you know, what we should do, but it's probably better received, and they'll probably learn more hearing from a peer that's similarly situated, that's also addressed the same issue. So, Jake, it's going to be a variety of strategies. Some of them are very concrete, like regulations and permits, and some of them are going to be more iterative and thoughtful, you know, like information exchange and networking and mentorship with other communities. And frankly, we're going to try everything until we get it right. Yeah, thank you. Absolutely. And for me, that's, you know, that's both mitigation and resilience, the green practices. So there's a role for gray practices, you know, clearly. But, you know, our emphasis over time has to be restorative practices, green practices. You know, Mother Nature's, she's a smart lady. You know, she knows what she's doing for the most part. But like all mothers, she needs some help. You know, and that's where green infrastructure comes in. Green infrastructure reintroduces natural processes into places that have been deprived of it. And, you know, she can work our magic. And just a sort of a rejoinder to my earlier comment about, you know, my experience in a little town dealing with flooding. You know, our next step after we dealt with the flooding and the gray infrastructure was we installed green infrastructure. And that was actually my first introduction to working with EPA Region 3. Is we got a tiny design grant, and we're able to design a green street that was able to handle 90% of the stormwater runoff. And it was provided placemaking in an urbanish area. It provided green space where there was a lot of blacktop and asphalt and concrete before, but it also showed that, you know, we can do sustainable practices that that do use Mother Nature, that are beautiful and that are achievable. You know, if some little town can do it, anybody can do it. Well, you know, that's a good question. And, you know, part of our strategy is going to be our messaging. So, you know, everything is local. You know, it's what people can see and touch every day, and people care about their backyard. They care about their neighborhood. They care about the local park. So this does exist already, but we're going to double down on local messaging. And, you know, a farmer in Pennsylvania may have never been and may never visit the Chesapeake Bay. Too bad for them. But, you know, they know their neighborhood. You know, they want their, you know, access to clean drinking water. They want to be able to recreate. They want to be able to swim. And, you know, no matter where you are in the watershed, you know, your distressed backyard stream in a few weeks is going to be a distressed Chesapeake Bay. So it's all connected. But really, you know, it's all local. So, you know, we need to be thoughtful when we're engaging folks who are not, you know, adjacent to the bay, that we're, you know, talking in their language about things that are real to them, because it is real to them and it is immediate to them. And we're going to be more successful to the degree that we can keep it more real. There's a few principles I'll share that I think answer your question. The first is strategically targeting, making sure that resources are going to get to places that are going to make the most difference. And it's that requires a little bit more us being proactive, because there might be a community that has a lot of resources, or a grantee that has a lot of resources that can apply for the grant and win the grant, but where they want to put it might not make that much of a difference. So we have to be strategic in making sure money gets to where it needs to be. The second concept is alignment, that we're aligning these programs to make the most difference. So if there's a target area here and a target area there, you know, we want to use all these resources to get to those places, you know, rather than, you know, scatter to the winds. So we want to make sure that we're aligning all the resources. It's not just money, but also intelligence, staff resources, data, you know, everything to the places that matter the most. Two other concepts I want to share. One is speed, that we have to be quick and work with organizations that can help disperse money and resources quickly. Sometimes that's a state government, sometimes it's not a state government, you know, sometimes it's not a federal government. So there's other grant makers that can get stuff on the ground and make sure it's working better. And then the last concept is scale. We want to make sure, you know, all these programs that we're doing things to a scale that's really making a difference. We're really lucky to be doing this work right now. We've got all that stuff that you just rattled off in more money and resources and intelligence going into this towards solutions than we've ever had before.